I am Anil Kumar. Welcome to my YouTube channel and the website Global Math Institute. In this video, we'll discuss application of tangent ratio. I will take 6 cases and examples from previous test papers. I hope you'll find this video useful and interesting. Enjoy the video with my student Abhinav, who is in grade 8.
Our approach, Engaging Minds, helps students think creatively and solve problems strategically. It helps them to connect with the context, visualize strategies, apply learnings, and bridge the gaps. Join Anil Kumar classes, gain confidence, and get ready for future. We develop mathematical and social skills for excellent performance of our students. The gift of education. I can be part of your success story. Build strong foundation, ensure bright future. Join Anil Kumar classes. Send an email on the address given here. Let us now enjoy the class with Abhinav.
Hi Abhinav, how are you doing?
I'm good, how are you?
Very good, very good. So today, what do you want to learn?
Kind of pick up where we left from last class and more on like trig equations.
So trig equations. We were doing tan ratios, trigonometric ratios, right?
Yeah.
We'll look into more word problems based on tangent ratios, and then we'll look into the trigonometric equations. Okay?
Good.
So here, in today's lesson, we'll talk about applications of tangent ratios. As you know, tangent is the ratio of opposite side over adjacent side, correct?
Yeah.
So we'll focus mainly on the tangent ratio, which is the ratio of opposite side to the adjacent side.
Okay.
So we have many applications where we will be using tangent ratios. One of them is very common, and that is to find the slope or the gradient of any curve, correct? So okay. That is a very good application. For example, if we have a straight line, as we could have, on a coordinate plane, let us say there is a straight line. In that case, the slope of the straight line is what? Is rise over run, right?
Yeah.
You can see clearly, if this is the angle theta, then rise over run is actually tan theta. So tangent ratio directly gives you the slope of any particular line, right? Which is slope m. So what we have done here is on a circle, we have taken a point P. So as you can see here, on a circle, we have a point P whose coordinates are x, y in general. So for different angles, we can have different coordinate points P, especially if the hypotenuse is 1. So that is what we call as a unit circle. So okay. Here we have a unit circle. So in this unit circle, the coordinate points x and y can be calculated using special triangles. You remember the special triangles, right? So you can use the special triangles and find the coordinates of x and y. Some of them are given to you right here. So if the angle is 0, then the point will be 0, 0. If the angle is 30 degrees, then it will be square root 3 over 2 and 1 over 2. You also understand that these points P, X, and Y actually represents the value for cosine and sine theta.
Yeah.
Since what is cos theta? Cos theta is this X value over 1 in this case, right? Hypotenuse is only 1. Therefore, x is cos theta and sine theta is this y value. Since sine theta is y over 1. So sine and cosine theta value are directly read from the points on unit circle. Tan theta will now be the ratio of sine and cosine. So that means y value over x value. So if you have the coordinate points on a unit circle, you can divide the y value by x value to get the tan theta.
Okay.
Right? So that becomes the tan theta. And this is also same as the gradient. If the point is shown going from the origin, right? Because unit circle center is origin.
Yeah.
So unit circle center is origin. Therefore, this gives you the gradient directly. And therefore, you also get the equation of line because it is a direct variation, right?
Yeah.
Y goes to m times x since it is going through the origin. So you get the gradient, you get the equation of line, and you can also get the trend. If tangent ratio is positive, means it is increasing, correct?
Yeah.
And if tangent ratio is negative, slope is negative, the line is decreasing. So you get all this information from the tangent ratio and the coordinate point on a unit circle. You see how important it is?
Yeah.
Right. And you will also notice that if the line is horizontal, in that case, tan will be zero as you expect, right?
Yeah.
But if line is vertical, in that case, we'll have infinitely large value. Because in this case, cos theta is zero, right?
Yeah.
So vertical line, slope is undefined. You get the idea?
Yeah.
So that is the reason. So at 90 degrees, tan theta is undefined. Now, the question for you is right there. Can you answer this question? Find the acute angle formed by the following lines and the x-axis, round to whole number. So the first equation is given to you as y equals to x minus 1. So what is the acute angle which this line will form? Can you tell me how will you approach this question?
Okay. So since tan theta is basically the slope because it's y, the rise over the run, so y over x.
Yes.
The slope is 1.
Yes.
So then tan of theta equals 1.
Yes.
And then you can use inverse tan to find
or inverse tan to get the angle which is 45 degrees. Correct. Very simple. So basically, given any equation, find the slope. Write it in the terms of y equals to mx plus b. And equate tan theta to m. And then you know what theta is. Theta is equals to tan inverse of m. You get the angle as shown in the figure. Very simple, right? Now, next question for you is question number 2. Find the acute angle formed by the line and y-axis. Acute angle formed by the line and the y-axis. So, between the line and the y-axis, it could be this angle or that angle, the acute angle with the y-axis. Is it okay? How will you approach this type of a question?
Okay, so first has to get it into simpler form.
Correct.
We've got negative 13y equals negative 12x minus 6, and y equals 12 over 13x plus 6 over 13. So correct. Slope is 12 over 13.
Right.
So tan theta equals 12 over 13. And then you can use the inverse tan of 12 over 13 to find it.
You got theta, which is the angle with the x-axis. You need to find the angle with the y-axis. So that will be the complementary angle, 90 minus theta, correct?
Yeah.
So you get your answer. Perfect. Now, very interesting question which is asked sometimes is angle between two lines. So here is your question for you. Find the acute angle at which these two lines intersect. So we have now two different lines and we want to find the acute angle of intersection between these two lines. So the approach could be what? Well, we can find individual angles they make with the x-axis. Somewhere they are going to intersect. So that makes a triangle. And in the triangle, we can use the property. External angle is sum of those two internal angles, correct?
Yeah.
So this external angle theta 2 is sum of theta 1 and phi. Phi is the angle, which is our answer. We can isolate as difference of external angle theta 2 minus the other internal angle theta 1. And that gives you the answer in this particular case as 45 degrees. Is this concept clear to you?
Yeah.
Very important. So if you are given two equations, you can use slope to find individual angles they make with the x-axis, and then exterior angle theorem to find the point at which that angle is made, right? Find the angle, yeah. The point of intersection. Perfect. So these were very good applications for tan theta. Now, here are a few more. Most of the questions dealing with angle of depression and angle of elevation. In these examples, we use tan theta, right? So, what is angle of depression? When you are looking down, let's say a plane is going and you see down some target, that angle which makes with the horizontal is the angle of depression. Now, if you're looking upwards, looking at a bird somewhere or tree top, then the angle of elevation is along, is from the ground, what eye is looking at,
sight,
line sight. So that is the angle of elevation. Both these angles with the tan ratio relates height and distance. Do you see that? Tan theta is opposite over adjacent. So it is basically height and distance. So height and distance questions can be solved very easily using tangent ratio, correct?
Yeah.
So you can see that tan theta is h over d. So you can find height as product of distance into tan theta. And yeah. Then you can find the same equation can also be used to find the angle as tan inverse of height and distance. So those are some very good examples. Now, based on this, we could have many different situations. So I have actually divided this into six different situations to help you understand how different types of questions in the book can be answered. And many real life situations can be modeled. That is the whole idea, right? So we could have a basic situation, which is just height and distance as shown here. Sometimes what happens is that we cannot actually measure the distance from the point to the base of the object, right? Let us say we have some lake here, river, right? Or something, right? So you cannot measure how much distance is this. In that case, we are in a position to measure the other distance. So we can like take an angle from one place, walk 100 meters, take another angle of the top, and then use these two angles to find the height of the object. So height and distance questions could be answered in this fashion also. This method is also used for finding height of mountains. You understand?
Yeah.
Huge application. Now, there could be a situation where you are at an elevated place and you can find height at which you are there, or you can find the height of something else by just using both angle of elevation and angle of depression. And there also tan theta can help you. Perfect. We could have a situation, for example, we have a flag which is being hosted on a building, right? Or let's say on a temple, let's say. We want to find the height of the flag or this period. Do you understand? So those kinds of questions can also be answered just by measuring the angle of elevation of base of the flag and top of the flag. We will get an idea how long the flag is or flagpole is. You get the idea?
Yeah.
Now, there are many 3D situations where we can use these concepts of angle of elevation and do the measurements to find their height. As I was saying, height of mountains also. If this is a region where we have a lot of complications, let's say in between we have some river here and you are far away. For example, let's say if I have to measure the height of a tower, for example, from the city. Now, you know, it is not accessible from every place. You may have very restricted places to check the angle of elevation. You get the idea. Maybe there are some skyscrapers in between. You have to go on the side and then take this angle, correct? So practical difficulties make it sometimes difficult to get to very convenient points. In that case, we use a 3D model. So accessible objects and inaccessible objects, both can be taken care of by such measurements, just by measuring angle of elevation from different points and knowing those two points and the distance between them. You get the idea?
Yeah.
So these are huge applications which we can look into. So I'm skipping first few since these are very simple ones and many times you have come across them, correct? For example, here, can you please read question number three, example three?
A searchlight beam lights up a helicopter that is descending vertically at a horizontal distance of 1.5 kilometers for the searchlight. If the angle of elevation of the searchlight is 55 degrees, how high is the helicopter? What would be the angle of elevation of the searchlight beam, if the helicopter was 1 kilometer high?
So it is basically height and distance question related with tan theta. Once you know two of these things, you can find the third. So simple and straightforward question, which you can definitely do based on what we have already done, right? So, so that was, now let's move on to the next question. Here is a real life situation. Can you please read the question?
A badger with poor eyesight depends on the hunting guide bird to locate beehive, and the bird gets treat to sweet honey as the strong claws of badger rips apart the beehive. Normally, the bird points at an elevation angle, A, then fly closer to the tree, pointing again at an angle, B. Badger has worked out a formula to calculate the distance and the height of the beehive from these observations. Badger visualizes the situation as shown in the figure and works out the distance using the following formula.
Correct. It is a real-life situation, a real story. This is how the birds and animals help one another. So, the birds have very good eyesight, as you know. So, honeybird is very fond of honey and can locate honeybees, beehives. Badger, on the other hand, has very strong claws. So, honeybird guides badger to the beehive so that badger can rip the beehive apart and both of them can have a good tree. You get the idea?
Yeah.
So, how does this happen? So, the bird points at an angle, like you point with your finger, well, that side, that direction. So bird points at an angle, then moves some more distance, and then again points. And badger gets the location very clearly. Oh, that is the place you're talking about, correct?
Yeah.
Now, in trigonometry, as we know, height distance can be done with tan theta. There, we have formulae, which can work out the height of the beehive very easily from these two angles, alpha and beta. So height is d times the distance which the bird walked or flew to before pointing, after first pointing, then the other angle. So that distance and those two angle of elevations will directly give you the height and you can calculate, right? So can you derive this formula? That is an exercise, okay? So that could be an exercise. And once you derive the formula, for given values of alpha and beta, we can easily calculate the height. So it is worthwhile doing this exercise, correct?
Yeah.
I'd like you to make a note of this exercise, but we will go through the definition, derivation of this formula just now within a minute, okay? So if you look at the smaller triangle right there, in that case, we know tan beta is what? H over x, right? So tan beta is h over x. From here, you can write h in terms of x and tan beta. So we get our equation number 2. Now you analyze the bigger triangle ADC, where the angle is alpha. So tan of alpha is basically h over d plus x, right?
Yeah.
And so h is equals to d plus x and tan alpha multiplied with it. So these two equations, both of them, give you the height relation, correct? So you can equate one equation to the other. So writing one equation equal to the other, and then simplifying, we get a formula for x, the unknown distance or the distance from the bird second spotting to the base of the tree. And knowing x, we can substitute the value of x in our equation number 2 times tan beta, we get the height of this particular location, correct? So yeah. We have a standard formula, height equals to d tan alpha times tan beta over tan beta minus tan alpha, correct?
Yeah.
So do you find it interesting? You can actually, therefore, solve many questions. Now, look at this question. Can you please read question number 4, example 4, and then tell me the answer? Easy calculation now, once the formula is known to us.
The honeyguard bird leads the badger to a beehive. The bird points at an angle of elevation of 30 degrees and then flies 20 meters closer to the tree and points at an angle of 60 degrees. Estimate the height of the beehive on the tree.
Right. You know the formula? Height is d tan alpha tan beta over tan beta minus tan alpha. That is alpha, that is beta. Substitute the values and calculate your answer, correct?
Yeah.
So easy now. So you do not have to do all that derivation once all this concept is clear to you. I have purposely used 30 degrees and 60 degrees since you can use special triangles to work it out, correct?
Yeah. 1 over square root of 3 times square root of 3. And the denominator, I got 3 minus 1 over square root of 3.
Yeah. So you got this expression which can be simplified, right? So multiply by square root of 3. And then once you simplify, you'll get your answer as 10 square root 3 as the answer. Is that clear to you?
Yeah.
Okay. So good job. So you see how convenient it was to work, first understand the situation so you can model the situation. Once you know, plug in the values, get your answer, correct?
Yeah.
So we do have that particular thing. Now in this part, I'm showing you, we'll discuss this later.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll take another. So this is another very simple example where we need to find the height, right? So can you please read this question?
Okay. From the top of a building 21 meters tall, the angle of elevation of the top of the taller building is 46 degrees. The angle of depression from the base of the taller building is 59.39 degrees. What is the height of the taller building?
Correct. So we are, and the angle of depression is, this is 59 is not there, it's only 39 degrees, it's a typing error, okay?
Okay.
There should be tan 39 degrees, right? As shown in the diagram, angle of depression is 39 degrees. So in this diagram, we can easily find the solution, which is what is the height of the taller building. So we want the total height, right?
Yeah.
Now, since we know this height of point A, we can actually form a triangle right there. And as you can see, this angle of 39 will be the same as this angle of 39, correct?
Yeah.
So we can find the horizontal distance A to B. This is same, right?
Yeah.
Using tan ratio. So that's what we have done here. So we'll say tan of 39, because this angle is 39, is opposite side over AB, 21 over AB, and this distance AB is equal to 21 over tan 39, which is 25.93. So once you get this distance AB, in that case, you can again use tan ratio to find the height, right?
Yeah.
So you find this side, and you can actually add those two heights and get the answer, correct?
Yeah.
You know this height is 21.3. The only thing is find this height and add to the original given, and you have your answer, correct? Easy, simple as that?
Yeah.
Perfect. So let's take up more examples. Example number 5. So based on the applications which I discussed with you earlier, we have one question each for every case. So here is example 5 for case 4. Can you please read and answer this question?
Okay. Anil wants to find the length of the pole, AB, that is on the roof of a building, CB. The angle of elevation of A and B are 50 degrees and 36 degrees, respectively from D. Their distance, CD, is 50 meters. Find the length of the pole.
Right. How will you do it?
Okay, so basically, you can, since you have the whole angle of D is 50 degrees and the whole base is 50 meters, you can find the height for the whole thing and then find the smaller height for BC, and then you can subtract, you can do AB minus BC. Good. I mean AC minus BC.
That is how you'll do it. Perfect. Now let's look into 3D questions, correct? Can you please read this question?
Yeah. To find the height of CN Tower in downtown Toronto, Canada, O'Neill took advantage of the perpendicular roads. A crossing where the east-west road intersects the north-south was selected as point O. OT was marked as the baseline, 50 meters long, where T is due east of O. Angle of elevation to the top of CN Tower from T is 75 degrees. Find the height of CN Tower if O is 110 meters due south of the tower.
Right. You understand. So the question becomes very complicated. So when you have a 3D question, you have to read properly and understand and make a diagram. You get the idea. The diagram is just before you. We are saying the CN Tower is CN. So this is CN Tower. And there is a point O selected. There are, you know, skyscrapers. You cannot really find the angle of elevation so easily. So you have two points now, O and T. Now along, this is a horizontal line because it has been given, their directions are perpendicular. You get the idea, east, west, and south, north, south. So they are perpendicular. So that means that the angle which we are talking about here is 90 degrees, right?
Yeah. So
this angle at the base is 90 degrees. We know the angle of elevation from T. We know the distance 50. And now we can easily calculate and find all the answers, correct?
Yeah.
So that is how we can actually work out, because we know these two sides in the right angle. So we know the hypotenuse. We can use the Pythagorean theorem here, which you have done. So once you use the Pythagorean theorem, you know distance n to t. Once you know that distance, simple tan ratio will give you the height, correct? So tan of 75 cn over tn, and then we get our answer approximately 450 meters. Is that clear to you?
Yeah.
But the important part is to understand and make a diagram just as we did in this particular case. Now, let's look into example 7. Can you please read this question?
Okay. The angle of elevation to the top of the tower is 32 degrees from point A due south of it. The angle of elevation to the top of the tower from another point B due west of the tower is 40 degrees. Find the height of the tower if the baseline distance AB is 45 meters.
Always we have a baseline. So on the horizontal plane, we are actually measuring the angle of elevation from two points, and we know those two points A and B and the distance between them. That's very important to solve these questions, correct? Now, we're talking about angle of elevation, and the term is due south. It means you are on the south side of the object. And due south means you are looking north. On a diagram, when you make a 3D figure, we will always draw X in this form. You see, this is your X axis. That is your Y axis. And then we have your Z axis showing the height. So as a corner of a room you look at, correct? So that is how you will position the things. You get the idea? Once you position it along these axes, it becomes very simple to sketch the diagram. Due south, do you see from O, I have taken A, due south along this point, right?
Yeah.
Due west, not east, I have taken point B, so that is the other point, correct? So I got this. And then when we talk about the angles, they are, now looking at these triangles, the triangles are at right angles, correct?
Yeah.
This is also right angle, and that is also right angle. You understand? So that is how you have to visualize. If you can visualize correctly, you can easily get the solution. Perfect. Now, looking at the right angles which I have made, have a good look at the diagram which has been made. Focus on that, and then the solution will be very easy to you. Correct? You're only working in two different right angle triangles and figuring out how do we get other values, correct?
Yeah.
Fine. So look at it. I'll share the video. Then you can always, you know, pause at the question and answer the question yourself. But does it make sense to you? Is this clear to you?
Yeah.
If I give you the question like this, you'll be able to sketch the diagram and answer, correct?
Yeah.
Very good. So we'll move on to the next question. Here's another question. I'd like you to read the question and understand how do we sketch the diagram for such a question. Can you please read the question?
Anil and Ben are watching a falcon perched on a nearby branch of the tree. Anil is facing north and has an angle of elevation of 20 degrees to the bird. Ben is facing west. Ben sees the bird at an elevation of 16 degrees. Determine the height of the falcon if the distance between Anil and Ben is 50 meters.
Correct. So Anil and Ben. So these are forming the baseline, as I was saying, right? Let's try. And we know the distance between them. Do you see the common things which is coming up, right?
Yeah.
And this is a horizontal thing. We have not written there in the question. It is always assumed to be horizontal plane. Now, think as if it is the tabletop, right? And they're both watching a bird which is on a vertical side, like a roof of the other building. You get the idea?
Yeah.
So from Anil, the angle of elevation is 30. Anil is facing north. Do you see that? And Ben is facing west. This is your west, right? 16 degrees. So is that diagram absolutely clear to you?
Yeah.
So we have these two vertical triangles which give you angle of elevation, and on the ground we have another right angle triangle. Do you see this right angle triangle?
Yeah.
Which Anil Ben made with the base of the point where the bird is facing. Correct?
Yeah.
So combining these things, we can easily figure out the solution. So since we are given the height is to be calculated. We are saying let it be h. So from the height and angle 20, we can find a to o in terms of h, right?
Yeah.
Tan theta. And similarly, we can find o to b in terms of height. And then the base triangle is a right angle triangle, a square plus b square c square. We can equate the three and find the value of h, which is the only unknown in this particular case, correct?
Yeah.
That is going to be our approach. Simple as that, to find the height h, correct?
Yeah.
So the idea of today's lesson is to show you or share with you different type of questions where these tangent ratios can be involved, right?
Yeah.
Now, everywhere we have been saying that measure the angle of elevation, measure the angle of depression. How do we do so? So clinometers are the devices which help you easily measure the angle of elevation or depression. You get the idea? So I'd like you to read what is given on the screen.
Okay. A clinometer is a simple instrument used to measure slope. Both angle of depression and elevation can be measured. A narrow piece of wood or straw is glued to the base of large protractor to act as the line of sight. A weighted plumb line hangs from the midpoint of the baseline of the protractor. To use the clinometers, tilt the wooden base to align your line of sight to the tip of the object. Someone else should then read the angle made by the plumb line on the protractor. Angle of elevation will be 90 degrees.
Angle of elevation is 90 minus.
Where are you?
90 minus, is it? Yeah. So as you can see, such a simple instrument. Do you see that? So what you have done here is, this is your protractor, which is giving you angle, correct? Which is sticking on a scale, for example, right? And if you want to find the angle of elevation, just point it at that particular direction. The plumb line will always be vertical, right? This will always be vertical. It's a weight. And once you point, the protractor will give you from zero what angle it is. You can read this plumb line and the angle, correct? On your D. And you know this angle, but you want the angle of elevation, which will be 90 minus Z, correct? Well, this is with the vertical. You want with the horizontal, right? You want this angle, correct? So that will be 90 minus Z. So such a simple instrument, you can actually make this instrument and measure angle of elevation and depression and create your own problems. So what you need to do is go out in the field with a scale, glue a D protector, right? Put a plumb line, means a straight line, easy to read, that is why, correct? And then you can actually point, measure the angle, and then walk to the base of the tree, for example, right? And when you walk, you can walk, count your steps. You can say, well, 20 steps. And in terms of the units of steps, you can find the height of the tree so easily. You get the idea.
Yeah.
And then if you accurately measure one length of your step, you know, fairly good height, accuracy, height of the tree also. You see how practical this instrument is? It is called clinometer, right?
Yeah.
So it's good to know all this. That's the whole idea. Now, here is a test question for you. I'd like you to read. There's another instrument which is called theodolite. Now, okay. It's a slightly advanced instrument because, you know, for field survey, you can use clinometer, right? Practically. If you go out for field survey, you can always measure, use clinometer to find height and distance for, you know, many objects. But to get more accurate results, and you know, the objects could be far away, we might use binoculars or things like that to focus and all, right? So this is a theodolite, which you'll talk about now. Can you please read what this is, what this instrument is?
Theodolite is an optimal instrument for measuring angle between visible point and the horizontal and vertical planes. Latest versions have been designed to provide very accurate information about angles and distances, which can be electronically fed to the computer.
Correct. So now, like a camera, right? They'll just shoot a laser beam and then they'll find both distance and angle accurately, right? And then you can solve your problem. Okay. Can you please read example 10?
Okay. Flower pots are the rock pillars in the Bay of Fundy, Canada. The geologist set up a theodolite at A and measured angle BAC to be 35.2 degrees. Baseline AD, perpendicular to AB, was taken as 8 meters, and angle ADB measured at 62.3 meters. If the height of the theodolite is 1.2 meters, what is the height of the flower pot to the nearest tenth of a meter?
Got it. So flower pots have been, you know, natural sites, a very beautiful site at Bay of Fundy, because we have very high sea waves, and due to erosion of the rocks, mountains, we have those flower pots. It's a very beautiful site. I'll actually like you to search where Bay of Fundy is and see what this beautiful place is, right? Now, so here's a practical application. Perfect. We are using the right instruments, which are normally used to find height and distance, correct? And yeah. Here's to the real application of trigonometry, which you are doing at present, solving right triangles only. We are not yet into the oblique angle triangles or different things. Most simple form of trigonometry can help you solve such real life situations. You get the idea. That is the power and beauty of this particular thing. I will again like you to look into this solution and try to do it yourself so that you understand how do we solve such questions. Important thing in all these examples was, for 3D examples, we have a baseline. You get the idea?
Yeah.
To find the object's height, we are looking into another triangle, which is vertical. So we have two triangles to work with. One is vertical and one is horizontal plane on which we are standing, right? So yeah, and both are at right angles to one another. It's like a corner of the room. So you have a 3D figure before you, and it becomes very easy to work out distances and heights, as we've done in this example, right? Do you find it useful?
Yeah.
So we'll end actually our class at this moment. I'd like you to summarize today's learnings. I'll upload the video. You can actually then answer these questions yourself. That will help you to master what you've learned so far. Can you please summarize what you've learned today?
Okay, so we learned about different trig ratios and the tangent ratio to be specific, and how to solve triangles and word problems. And we learned about a couple of different cases on how we can solve these triangles, and we learned about two useful instruments that are used in the real world and are used in real life to find these applications.
Very, very good. So we'll end our class here today, Abhinav. I'll send you some questions to on this particular topic, and also for you to get ready for the next class. We'll be actually doing sine law and cosine law in the next class. Okay.
Okay.
So once we do sine law and cosine law, we'll be able to solve any triangle in general, not just the right angle triangle. Okay.
Okay.
Okay then. Bye for now. Have a good day.